This Land Is Your Land was never played on the radio, never played on TV. No famous person ever recorded it. It did, however, get in the schools, and some school songbooks printed it. And the kids loved it. And 15 years later, there were literally millions of kids all around the country knew this song. 25 years later, practically everybody in the country knew the song. It's true, I used to take it everywhere I went and sing it. Margie Guthrie, on her deathbed, she said, "Thank you, Pete, for spreading Woody's songs." Because Woody went in the hospital in 52. He was really an unreliable performer from about 48 on. He was always, in a sense, an unreliable performer. I remember 1940, I met him in Boston. I was hitchhiking through New England and somehow heard he was going to sing at some hotel raising money for some good cause. And he says, "Pete, come on, join us. Get a free meal." And so we were eating. Then he was introduced and went on stage and told stories. And after 15 minutes, the person in charge says, "Pete, could you go up and tell Woody people are expecting him to sing. And he was only supposed to be on for 10 minutes and it's already 15 minutes. So I went out from the wings and said, "Woody, the people say, wouldn't you please sing a song before you go because your time's up?" So he sang Ballad of Jesse James or something and then walked off.
And so after you met him, what led to you two going on the road together?
Well, I was a very naive, inexperienced 20-year-old, and he was 27, had been married for 10 years, fathered three children, and been on the radio and made records and done all sorts of things. He said to me, "That Seeger is the youngest man I ever knew. I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, didn't chase girls." But I had a good ear, and I could accompany him in anything. I didn't have to hear it once. The first time I heard it, I could hear a chord change coming, and I didn't play anything fancy. I just gave him a good, solid backing. I didn't try and play fancy breaks or anything. So he let me tag along with him.
And would you harmonize as well?
I would try and harmonize. Yeah, I could harmonize, okay. My voice wasn't that good.
So where did you start? You started.
He came to Washington because Alan Lomax wanted to record him for the Library of Congress. He stayed there whole weekend, just recording hour after hour on big 16-inch acetate discs. Jerome Wiesner, who later on was head of MIT, was in charge of the little recording studio that the Library of Congress had. And late one night, Woody says, "Pete, aren't there some mountains in Virginia?" And I said, "Yeah, beautiful mountains, Blue Ridge Mountains, they call them." He says, "How far are they?" I said, "Oh, they're a couple hours drive." He said, "Let's go out and see the mountains," this being midnight. And about 5 miles outside of Washington, there was an old lady with a big sack of some vegetables or something on her back walking down the road. And we stopped, says, "Can we give you, Auntie, can we give you a lift?" She says, "Well, thanks, boys. I will take a lift. This load's heavy." And she gets in the back seat. Then she says, "Where are you boys going?" "We're going down to look at the mountains." "What? You're going down to look at the mountains?" She said, "Boys, would you let me out, please?" "Hey, Auntie, you won't get another lift tonight." She says, "Please let me out." She didn't want to be with two boys at 12:30 wanting to look at the mountains. When dawn came, we saw the mountains.
What song came out of that?
I've forgotten. But then he had to go back to Texas to try and make up one last time with his wife. And he let me come along with him. Had a car, wasn't paid for. He paid the down payment. But he'd quit the job. He had what was then a very high salary, $200 a week, for the model tobacco. I think it was Model Tobacco. radio program. But he quit it. He said, they want me to sing stupid songs, and they wouldn't let me sing my songs. And his wife said, couldn't you kept the job for a few more weeks? We could have paid some bills off. But he wasn't going to do it.
So you take off in a car with Woody.
Well, his wife went back by train to Texas.
Do you remember what kind of car it was?
It had a Plymouth. It was a Plymouth, and he'd had it paid for a couple months. But we took off in the Plymouth, and he called it hitchhiking on credit. And we picked up hitchhikers. It was usually full of hitchhikers the whole time. We picked up a guy who was a cripple. And we asked him what his name. Well, they call me Brooklyn Speedy. And he said, you boys short of cash, let me off in front of the Woolworths here at this next town. In an hour, I'll have enough money for gas to get us to Memphis. And then let me off there. And sure enough, a few hours, he put a box of pencils out in front of him. And there he stood with no legs. He kind of hunched him along with some short crutches. He could move from the car a few feet. And when we got to Memphis, he said, you boys must be hungry. Here's some money for supper. I said, don't you want to come? He said, no, what I do want is a bottle of paregoric. I said, what's that? He said, well, you can get it at the drugstore and ask for 2 ounces. And they'll ask you to give your name. Don't give your real name, just write any old name. But I need 2 ounces of paregoric. I didn't know then it has a lot of opium in it. And when I bought it, he says, when they ask what's for, I say the baby has a stomachache. And the man says, why do you need so much? And I said, oh, the baby has a stomachache. He says, this will put the baby to sleep for 6 months. But he gave it to me for the price. It was several dollars for a little, tiny little jar of this brownish liquid. And I didn't know what it was. All I know, he took down one gulp. And then we drove on. And I said, what does it do? He said, it just makes me feel good. The world's moving past me. It takes all my worries away.
Hmm. How did he lose his legs?
What?
How did he lose his legs?
Never told us. But he was a paregoric addict and went from town to town.
So did the car get you to Texas?
Oh, we got it. It got us to Texas. And then we drove back to Oklahoma City. And that's where he gave it to the Communist Party of Oklahoma City to use for a while. And then company finally caught up with it and took possession of it. But Woody, by that time, had hitchhiked to New York, and I'd hitchhiked to Chicago because, I guess I went to Chicago first.
And then, you made it to Texas, the marriage didn't work out, or?
Yeah.
And
Mary was up close to giving up to him. She only Alan Lomax was asked if he could find a ballad singer to make up songs about the Grand Coulee Dam, and he recommended Woody. So now there was money, and he and Mary and the three kids go up to Portland, Oregon. And in one month, he writes 28 songs, just one song after another. And then I wrote him from New York saying, Woody, we got a group here called the Almanac Singers, and we sang in Madison Square Garden for the striking transport workers, 20,000 people, and they were singing your song. Like, you can't scare me, I'm sticking to the union. And you ought to come and join us. And poor Mary, this was one last time, he left her. And she went back to Texas and filed for divorce.
Hmm.
But now she's never said a mean thing about him. She said, we were just too young. And he wasn't the right husband for me. He was not a good father and not a good husband. But, and she found a very good man who she was, and they had a very happy life for, oh my gosh, another 60 years.